Story time with Stephanie Storey.
Hi, I am art historical novelist Stephanie Storey, and my guest today, we may have way too much in common to handle it in one conversation. We will see how it goes. It's ridiculous. We are both a bit obsessed with art during and set in Italy and the Italian Renaissance. She is the author of The Gondola Maker, The Painter's Apprentice. This one that just came out just now, this spring, The Giant, about, you know, my favorite guy, Michelangelo, and his carving of the David, as well as one coming out in the fall about my other favorite guy, Leonardo da Vinci, called The Night Portrait. So, yeah, we are going to overlap a lot. Can't wait for this conversation. Yeah. Welcome to the show, Laura Morelli.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me. I know we should just keep the record button on for hours, I think. So we have a lot to talk about.
Right? It's ridiculous. I have 800 things I want to ask you about, but I want to start with, you actually have your PhD in this stuff. Now, I started a PhD program and frankly chickened out. I was like, nope, I'm not going to do that. I like to make stuff. I'm going to go get my MFA in creative writing. But yeah. You have a PhD in art history. Why are you so obsessed with the stuff that you have a PhD and now you write novels about it?
Oh, it's such a long story, but you know, I started out as a kid wanting to be a writer. I mean, when people ask me when I was 4 years old, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? I always said I want to be a writer or an archaeologist, and I never veered from those things. And you know, when I was a teenager, between the ages of about 12 and 20, I was privileged to travel quite a bit. And I realized there was this whole world of art history out there, and I became really fascinated with it. I was then privileged enough to be able to go to graduate school and pursue art history as a graduate degree. And, you know, I just loved it. But always in the back of my mind, I thought, I'm a writer. You know, that was always my love, always my strength. But I pursued my academic studies, you know, fully expecting that I was going to graduate with my PhD, get a tenure track job in academia, teach at the college level, which I did for a while, and, you know, write academic work. But, you know, there was something about the stories of art history that just pulled me. And, you know, there is the historical record, right? The things that we know are true. And some of the stories, some of the true stories of art history are so incredible that you could not make them up. But I always found myself wondering about the part that we didn't know, you know, all of those things, those holes in the historical record, all of that stuff that that we don't know. And so for me, writing historical fiction, and specifically art historical fiction, is a way for me to marry what we do know and sort of imagine what might have happened, you know, what we don't know. There's a point where the research ends and the imagination and the fiction begins. And so for me, that's it's what I feel like I was meant to do, you know, ever. So it sort of married my loves of the true and the made up. And so I really can't think of anything I'd rather do. It's really exciting.
What are you, I have these conversations with myself about what I'm trying to do for readers who maybe don't know art history as well, or, you know, I want to excite them. I want to take these great artists off a pedestal and make them human. Do you have like particular thoughts of what you're trying to do for art history, or what you're trying to do for regular people who just go to a museum and they're trying to get into it? Because that's a lot of times why people read fiction, is they're trying to learn in a sort of friendly way with story.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I do think that you hit the nail on the head. You know, what my readers tell me, and I'm sure many of yours do too, is that reading a historical novel is a really fun way to learn about history, and that it brings history to life. And, you know, one of the things that I think, you know, was a source of friction for me in academia was that, you know, we're trained to go to academic conferences and stand in front of a room and read a 20-minute paper and it sounds very dry and boring and hard to understand. And, you know, I found myself sitting in an academic conference one time and just yawning and trying to keep myself awake. And I thought, something is wrong here, because, you know, art history is the most interesting and exciting topic in the entire world. And, you know, we academics have a way of making things really dry and dull sometimes. So a historical novel, I think, is a way to bring the past to life, and especially for someone who has no interest in earning a PhD in art history, but wants to go on a journey and immerse themselves in the past. I think a historical novel is a great way to do that.
Since you are an academic, do you ever have a hard time turning off the academic in your own head to get into the novel? Like, does it ever argue with you? Like, no, that's, you can't go that far with the fiction. Like, do you have an extra layer of that sensor in your head?
Yeah, I do. I think it's there. I mean, I feel a level of responsibility to keep what we do know true to the story. In other words, you know, yes, it's a novel, and yes, we make things up, but as far as we know the historical record, I try to really stay true to that. And I love contemporary sources. So if I'm writing a story in Venice in 1520, I will go and research every surviving document from that time period to really immerse myself in the language that people were using, what kinds of things they were worried about or anxious about, what they thought, you know, was interesting, because often it's very different than what we, you know, would be concerned about today. And, you know, I try to really bring that sense of that sensibility into the writing. But yes, there is a certain point where the research is done, and it is, and as much as I love it, it's set aside, and then the story really has to take precedence and has to have a life of its own. Otherwise, you know, people don't want to read just a list of a boring dates and facts of, you know, when things happened.
Or maybe you do, but you read other kinds of books to do that.
Right. You don't go to a historical novel for that.
No, but that's one of the reasons why I love your book. And I think that's why I wanted to start there, is because for me, as a historical novelist, you are so respectful of the history, and it stays really close. And the actual moment comes to life in a unique way, I think, with your writing. And I think it has to come from the fact that you're a genuine historian, you know?
Well, I love the research. I mean, I truly love it. And, you know, I'm a super geek, because I have gotten really cool scene ideas and story ideas out of footnotes. You know, the opening scene of my book, The Gondola Maker, is about the burning of a gondola, the public burning of a gondola, which was an act of justice. And that came from a footnote in the bottom of an academic journal that I read. And, you know, this kind of cursory mention of this public gondola burning in the 16th century. And I thought, wow, that is incredible to imagine. So that's an example of, you know, how we have just a little shred of a fact, a shred of a contemporary observation that then, you know, prompts a whole scene of a book. And that's, I just love that. I think it's really neat to imagine, just based on a little scrap, a little shred of evidence from the past.
Oh, come on. You're making my geeky heart patter. Like, oh, this is the greatest thing ever. Okay, but I have to get to this. Because I have already read this, which is The Giant, which just came out this spring. It's lovely. It is crazy for me to read, which I will ask you about in a moment, because I have also written about the creation of this guy. But you were writing about Jacopo Torni, who is one of Michelangelo's known assistants, friends. Like, he's mentioned by Vasari. He's mentioned in historical documents. We know he exists. But we don't... Do we know more about him than I think we do? Because I think we know very scant little about him. So this is a place where you got to fill in the dark places, right?
Yeah, and that's, you know, Jacopo Torni is almost the ideal main character for a historical novel because we know just enough about him, and what we do know about him is super fascinating, but it's not very much. And so it's just enough to kind of whet your appetite and just enough to go on. So what we know about Jacopo Torni is that he was a young man around Michelangelo's age. They were both apprenticed to Master Ghirlandaio as preteens. Michelangelo gets sucked out of Master Ghirlandaio's workshop and into the Medici Gardens, where, and he leaves his friend Jacopo behind. And Giorgio Vasari tells us that that Jacopo Torni and Michelangelo were intimate friends, is the way he describes it, and says that Jacopo was one of Michelangelo's favorite people to have around his table, that he found him the most funny and entertaining of his friends, that he played jokes on him, that he chatted his ear off while he was trying to focus. So you have this idea, you know, this picture in your head already of this very extroverted, engaging young man who, and then Vasari tells us that he's super lazy at the same time. So I just found it interesting to think about these two artistic friends, these two kind of opposing personalities. You know, we think of Michelangelo as this very brooding genius, you know, kind of tortured. He's the stereotype of this tortured, brooding genius on the one hand. And then on the other hand, you have this friend who's like this bright little happy, you know, jokester, and but maybe has a dark side. And so I thought it was interesting to explore this friendship between these seeming two opposites around the creation of the David, which is such a seminal work of art in the entire history of art. And so that's what kind of drew me to this as a novel. This book actually started out, believe it or not, 20 years ago as a nonfiction book about the David. And I think it was about 2000 that I started exploring this idea of writing a book about Michelangelo's David, leading up to 2004, which would have been, and was, the 500th anniversary of the unveiling of the David in the Piazza della Signoria in Florence, because it was unveiled in 1504. So I wrote this long 50-page proposal for this great nonfiction book. I gave it to my agent. She said, I love this, it's gonna sell. She took it to a publisher. The publisher said, darn it, I love this, but we just bought the same book from another author. And so I guess everyone had the idea that, you know, and with 2004 coming, you know, that was a great topic for a book. So I don't know if you know Anton Gill's Il Gigante.
That's what I was about to say. Was it Il Gigante?
Yes, it was.
Il Gigante, because it has to be.
It's a great book. And there have been, you know, a couple of other books since then about the David. But I had this proposal sitting in my drawer. And, you know, every once in a while, I'd pull it out and I'd look at it and I'd put it away. And somehow, you know, after I really turned to historical fiction full time, that story sort of nagged at me. It wouldn't let me go. I kept thinking, I just need to let this David story go. I just need to let it go. It's not going to go anywhere. But I realized at a certain point that it was kind of the epic drama of the creation and the unveiling and the public display of this sculpture that really seemed like it made more sense as a novel than as a nonfiction book. And so finally, you know, when I found my Jacopo as my narrator, you know, I decided to take it in that more fictionalized direction. So I guess it ended up how it was supposed to, but it just started out long ago and in a very different form.
Okay, before I ask you more about Jacopo, I know when I, because I wrote in Oil and Marble, I wrote about the same, mine is Michelangelo versus Leonardo, but same year, right. Same creation of David, same thing. And I was like intimidated by, what am I going to say new? What am I going to do? This story's already been told. Did you have that same fear, or did you feel like you automatically felt like you knew what new you wanted to bring to the, particularly the David part of the story?
Yeah, you know, it's a really good question. My first two historical novels don't have any real, you know, people in them. And so to write about someone like Michelangelo, or as you have Raphael or Leonardo da Vinci, it's a huge responsibility. I mean, I just feel like it's a completely different animal to write about a real person versus, you know, a made up character. And I definitely felt that writing The Night Portrait, which is my next 2020 historical novel, which is a dual timeline story and takes place partly in World War II. And it also has some real people. So talk about a burden of responsibility. You know, it's one thing if the person's been gone for 500 years, and it's another thing if they haven't been gone actually that long. So yeah, it's a burden of responsibility, I think, to do justice to a towering figure who everybody knows, and a towering work of art that everybody knows. So yes, I think I agree with you. I think it's a little intimidating. As I said, I tried to put this story away, and in part, I think it was that. It was feeling like, gosh, everybody knows this story, right? I mean, everybody knows the sculpture, knows the story, but it was just something about this particular work of art that wouldn't let me go. You know, just, I feel like in some ways in the history of art, Michelangelo's David is kind of like the turning point. It's the work that changed the history of sculpture. You know, it was the first monumental, colossal male nude for 1,000 years. And, you know, sculpture was never the same after that. And so I think that there was something about that story that still begged to be told in, you know, in a different way. And, you know, I think that Jacopo, our narrator, is, he struggles also with Michelangelo, you know, as this kind of intimidating, powerful presence, you know, someone at the same time magnetic, but not particularly very kind to him. And so, you know, I think all of us as creators can relate to that, to feeling, you know, intimidated by our projects, or by people who are ahead of us, or, you know, big authors that have gone before us that we admire, that seem like towering giants. And so that for me was an interesting theme to explore too. You know, as artists, I think every artist, no matter what medium they're in, probably can relate to feeling intimidated in some way by, you know, some kind of big project like that.
Well, and then Jacopo does give you the good, like bringing him in, bringing this other character who is struggling to paint his frescoes he's supposed to be painting, and he'd really rather be at the gambling hall. And, you know, he has all kinds of personal,
he's got some issues.
He has some issues, but he's adorable and he's really likable. But it gives you this interesting, as opposed to what I did, where I wrote from the point of view of Michelangelo and Leonardo, you wrote from the point of view of this outside character, which was an interesting way to look at the David and to see Michelangelo in a new way. Did you, after 20 years of working on this book, learn anything about Michelangelo by seeing him through the eyes of Jacopo Torni?
Oh, yeah, it's a good question. I think, you know, you had asked me another time why I thought it was interesting to focus on the David in this period versus, let's say, the Sistine Chapel, which, you know, is Michelangelo in all of his mature glory. And I think that what I found interesting about Michelangelo at this time is that he is still not totally established yet. You know, he's grown up in Florence. He, after the Medici were expelled from the city, he was lost for a couple of years, sort of wandered to Venice and Bologna. No one knew who he was yet. He was still really young. He went to Rome almost as a student studying abroad would go to Rome today. You know, if you were an art student, you'd show up with a bag and some, you know, a sketchbook and some chalk and change of clothes, and that's about it. And that's sort of where he was in his life at that time. He was lucky in that he got this commission from a cardinal to sculpt the Pietà, which is now in St. Peter's in Rome. And that really, you know, sort of made a name for him in Rome, at least. But in Florence, back home, people still didn't really, you know, think he was anything that special. And so the David was really his mark, his first mark in his career. And so I just found that an interesting time to think about an artist still in development, you know, who's really ambitious and just starting his career, and then to just come out with something like the David at 26 years old. I mean, that's an amazing thing. And so I really enjoyed exploring that particular time in his life, you know, before he got recognition from the popes and, you know, all of that. I just found that an interesting time period.
Okay, so then you've already brought up the night portrait, which I was going to ask you about, because spoiler alert at home, I've read it too. It's fabulous. It is like page turning. Oh my gosh, dual timelines. You're like, I can't put this down. So what did you get? This is your first dual timeline story, right? Where you did, yeah. You were saying earlier, where you had to reference people who are still sort of alive and still a family alive. Yes. Why did you want to do that dual timeline, and what did it give you as a writer to look at that story in a different way?
Yeah, so this was a really different kind of book for me to write. You know, I described my 20-year, you know, odyssey with the giant. You know, in a lot of ways, the night portrait, which is coming out in September, was the complete opposite of that. It came out very quickly. I just sort of had the idea and put it together very quickly. So for me, it always starts with the work of art, right? So this story started for me with Leonardo da Vinci's famous portrait of the lady with the ermine. And I think portraits are always fascinating anyway, because you wonder about the sitter and what the relationship is between the artist and the sitter and why the portrait was made and all of that. So this particular portrait is particularly interesting both in the 15th century and in the 20th century, because the sitter, Cecilia Gallerani, who was a teenage girl at the time and ended up as the mistress of the Duke of Milan, she was kind of an object of desire in the 15th century for this much older Ludovico Sforza, who was the Duke of Milan at the time. And then 500 years later, lo and behold, she becomes the object of desire yet again for this high-ranking Nazi leader who was the governor of Poland, Hans Frank, who later became known as the Butcher of Poland for the atrocities that he oversaw there, starting with the Nazi invasion of Poland in 1939. He also was obsessed with this particular portrait and this girl painted in the portrait. So I thought it was interesting to think about this portrait, you know, separate with powerful men separated by 500 years who were obsessed with this picture. And I wanted to know what it was about this picture that, you know, made it such an object of desire. And so that's how this story got started. So the story goes back and forth between the 1490s and the 1940s, and it centers around the portrait for the entire story.
But one of the things I wanted to ask you about is you happened to, and I asked you this over email when I saw it came out, you happened to contribute to a book about plagues and resilience through history that came out on March 1st of this year. Yeah. Which is just like,
I swear we did not make that up.
you didn't know the coronavirus was coming?
Isn't that crazy?
And you've also written a short story, Bridge of Sighs, right? That's about the bubonic plague.
Yes, so, I have three plague short stories, and The Painter's Apprentice, one of my novels, takes place in a time of plague in Venice.
So what?
Yeah, it's a theme.
So what do you know about this kind of plague era, about how it plays out and how, particularly since you are an art history PhD and you write about how art survives, thrives, doesn't, changes during times of plagues or pandemics?
Mm-hmm. Really interesting. Oh gosh, that's such a huge topic, and it's fascinating. I've always found it interesting how people have managed and coped in times before modern medicine, and you know, and how it relates to art is interesting. One of my favorite academic art history texts is a book about Florence and Siena after the Black Death. And the premise of the book is how art changed after this massive and devastating pandemic hit central Italy in the 1300s. And, you know, at that time, you saw a lot more images, a lot more religious imagery, a lot more imagery around death and the afterlife and those kinds of themes. So it's interesting, and I think it'll be interesting to see what kind of art emerges from this time. You know, I've had people send me messages and emails and say one of two things. They either say, oh my gosh, I can't believe you had a plague story published on March 1st. And I went to read all of the plague stories in this anthology, which is called We All Fall Down. And, or I have people write and say, you know, I'm sorry, but I just can't read that right now. It's too close to reality. I'm going to put it on my, you know, to be read pile for later after this period of time is over. So I think people look to stories and people look to art as a way to understand their own lives and their own challenges. And so, you know, whether you find it helpful to, you know, watch post-apocalyptic movies right now, or you have no interest whatsoever in watching that kind of stuff, you know, it's fine. It's just people's way of coping and processing what's happening right now.
This, I could talk to you for, honestly, 5 hours.
I know, I could too. We should just go open a bottle of wine and just continue on this conversation.
Because we do, there's so much that's in common, but there's also just this interesting difference in dialogue that happens that I find really fascinating. And I happen to love your books too, which really helps.
Thank you. Well, the feeling is mutual. I love yours too. I had the privilege of reading Stephanie's Raphael book just before it published, and it's fantastic. So
thank you.
Read it.
yeah. Weird moment to come out with the books, but we've done it. And we're out braving it, and it's happening.
Stephanie's story time virtually. We've got time and plenty of stories, talking stories in a novel way. Story time with Stephanie's story.